Rastafari Sabbath Study Number 46, Rastafari Sabbath Tenet, Poverty, Ignorance, and Disease, Three Enemies of Rastafari. Let's go straight into it. You know, this is all going to be covered, this is all going to go into last week's Torah portion studies, because today is Ehud, the first day of the week. It is Sunday, August 19th, and so getting right into it, what does ignorance, poverty, and disease have to do with, you know, RSS number 46? Well, let me begin by saying this. The basis of racial discrimination and colonialism has been purely economic, and it is with economic weapons that these have been and can be overcome. Okay, so Ayanda is going to be dealing with economics, and so our problems are based on economics, and it is with economic weapons that they have been overcome, and Ayanda will overcome and can overcome. So let us and this is coming from the Ultimate Challenge speech, 1963, United Nations Assembly, October 6th or 7th, Kedamawi Haile Selassie being the composer of one of his many great speeches. Nonetheless, let us not lose focus. One idea prior to that is we Africans will fight if necessary, and we are confident that we shall win. We know that we shall win because we are confident in the victory of good over evil. The first chapter 7 of the book of Deuteronomy, verse 12, it begins with if. With that, it doesn't begin with if, but if is the main word. If. That conditional if. Well, we are guaranteed that we know that if we do what's right and if we fight the good fight, then we know we will win. There's no doubt, because we are confident in the victory of good over evil. So let that be true, everything else a lie. Continuing, today I stand here before the world organizations which succeeded to dismantle, discarded by its discredited predecessor and its bodies enshrined the principle of collective security, which was unsuccessfully invoked at Geneva, Switzerland. I just threw that in there because, as we are all aware, I'm sure, and if not, well, here you go. The book of Deuteronomy, Dudo, it would be like, or Dute. Do is kind of like deuce, like double. The repetition, we know it's repetition, and onomos is law, the repetition of the law. So, this speech is perfect. It's like if when Moses went up to receive the Ten Commandments, it's like if His Majesty was reciting this speech. It could even be interpreted that way, having fun with scripture, but it makes sense. But anyways, continuing. So it's this. I threw that in there to show how the speech and this week's, or for the past 3 weeks, Bible studies have been kind of like a reflection of this, of the Ultimate Challenge speech. Now let I continue by mentioning that I and I have a covenant. We have a deal with Jah. We have a working out. A kalkidam, a word agreement. And so, let I remind all and all, even I, that these two, as were the phrases of the covenant, are only words. Their value depend wholly on our will to observe them and honor them and give them content and meanings. It's the same. If it fits perfectly, if we keep His judgment, statutes, commandments, and walk in His way, that if we walk in that way set by Adonai, Jesus Christos, if we follow that perfect example, because it is our responsibility, every man and woman, to to do their maximum, their best, to live a life as closely as possible as that perfect example set by, Adonai Jesus Christos, the life which every man must emulate and try to duplicate, as closely as possible. So, just continuing, these are the objectives: yesterday unobtainable, today essential, which we must labor to achieve. We have a job, we're workmen, need not be ashamed, and so there are a couple of, there are some objectives that His Majesty is kind enough to point out, but what are these objectives? Well, first, that we must labor towards. And so let us continue. Let's find out what those objectives are. Two particular issues. So now we're going to be informed on what are these objectives. Two in particular: disarmament and the establishment of true equality. So let's not write it down. Pretend it's okay. Never mind. Don't pretend. But know that disarmament and the establishment of true equality are two objectives. Now let us receive some advice from His Majesty, so gracious, so compassionate, to have laid out plain and simple for us to receive, if the will is there. In 3 days, the 32 nations who presented themselves at this conference demonstrated to the world that when the will and determination exist, nations and peoples of various backgrounds can and will come together, for a common goal, for our unity and achievement, so without a doubt, Africa and 32 different nations of different backgrounds, colors, ideas, cultures, everything, when the will and determination is there, it has been proven that we can come together. So let I and I come together, in harmony, cooperation. Let poverty, ignorance, and disease be overtaken by understanding, tolerance, and goodwill, And so let that be that. But let us go into scripture now. Or let us review what the world, seclarum, what the worldly view of economics is, because we're going to be dealing with economics, and because it is with economic weapons that these have been and will be and can be overcome. So this is, I guess it would be Jah's economy, but okay, so the disarmament, it's all going to fit together perfectly. The disarmament of our enemy is in fact our economy. And, we'll get into that soon enough. But let I just mention, what is economy? So economy, let's get into what the world view, some of these worldly philosophers claim economy to be. So it would be actually, give I a second. Oh boy. Okay, so rules of the house, management of a house, administration. Okay, so in our case, first let's go over the worldly view of economics, and then let us review I and I economics. So just to make mention that before, economy was in fact known as political economy. But you know the wicked them, they mix things up, and they don't want the obvious to be seen, right? At this point, who knows if people would even notice, but anyways, nonetheless, they narrowed it down to economics and canceled out the political, so that to hide the fact that it was a science like of interest. And one example is mathematics, you know, math ethics. And then, you know, wicked them, they cancel the good part, which is ethics, and you're left with nonsense and foolishness, numbers, you know, numbers that are not applicable to ethics, you know. So just an example of how they, how, you know, some of this mind control. So continuing, it's even as clear, the research was even as clear as to mention that analysis applied to crime, education, family, law, politics, religion, and war, social institutions, and science is in fact economic imperialism. Maybe that's significant, as Ayindar God and Father Haile Selassie first, he mentioned that newly risen dragon, maybe in a sense, it could be imperialism through economics. Indeed, in fact, it is, and well, not limited only to, but it is partially at least that. So continuing, so economy, they kind of twisted things up so that the study of man's behavior and the study of wealth with certain influences. So these economists established what is the pursuit of an object, you know. So the pursuit of any object to influence man. So economics, the study of man with the influence of the pursuit of any object, which inevitably, you know, if you could look around, you know, it results in people doing unbelievable, believable, but horrific things to obtain these objectives. And let us kind of go to the constitution of spiritual Egypt. The pursuit of happiness is one of these, is probably one of the most influential ideas that you know, that has increased and multiplied and encouraged crime and all these horrible things that are out there. The idea of happiness, how they've converted happiness to a god, you know, because you know, way back then when people were sane in the membrane, happiness was an emotion to be used at will, you know, or you know, sometimes influenced by certain events. Nonetheless, it was an emotion. Now it's a god, a deity, a way of life, you know, the way to live your life, happy at what cost, I would ask them. At the cost of starvation and, oh, well, let's get into it. Check this out. So, the study of another great great philosopher's opinion, idea, which most economists accept to be true, is that economy is the study of man, the study of man's behavior influenced by scarcity. What is scarcity? They want to imagine and define this as lack of resources. You know, it's only to a fool that does not know how to properly apply and use the resources for the commonwealth. It is only them that can think of this crazy idea of lack of resources, which is completely untrue. You think Jah would set us up in a land, you know, lacking resources, or rather it's foolish people using up resources like vainly. So continuing, scripture is gonna let us define scarcity for Ayindar, because no such thing in Jah promised land, you know. So scarcity, poverty, the influence of man's behavior, the study of man's behavior influenced by poverty, you know, that would be more precise, but they will never admit to that. Continuing, what is money? Brother Yadon always constantly, he's right on. It goes as far as defining that the success of money only survives with mass public confidence. So, let us forward to go to the God of happiness. You know, the Chinese, and I don't know a whole lot about this, but I do know that one of the seven gods, Buddha, one of the seven Buddhas, and this is not the other Buddha, you know, forgive I for not doing justice to what I'm about to say. It's in no way intended to disrespect, you know, the Buddhist beliefs and all of them, you know, in Chinese. But this is regarding I and I economy, you know, so just pointing out that happy face, this happy face right here is in fact the seventh god of, or one of the seven gods of, I believe he's the god of good luck. He carries around his neck a string full of prayer beads, and then he carries a sackcloth with the objects that of, like, I guess, like material property that I guess this would be it would be like representative of the fortune, good fortune. And so yeah, that's what that is, you know. So Hotai or Hoti is the name of this fictional entity. I'm sure somewhere down the line it was not supposed to be represented as a deity more. It's probably the same confusion that most of us are under, where we don't know anything about something and then we just call it, oh, it must have been their god, you know. So I say that just to make clear that I and I is not jumping to conclusions or anything. I and I don't even know, not even enough to even be worthy of speaking of the matter. And let us continue, because I have, right? But so living a good life rather than happiness, living a good life rather than emotion. So that's basically pretty much what I and I wanted to share. But take note, phenomena, that, you know, it was clear that the only thing that could disrupt this way of economy was the phenomena. And that, you know, that word is interesting, but most of all, that idea that, you know, the wicked them have always known that I and I, Rastafari, you know, the beta Rastafari were to rise, you know, and they knew it, and we are described as a phenomena. This is not the only place where this is where they point this out. So, you know, doing some research, it even mentioned that the only thing that would disrupt this way of life, the pursuit of happiness, would be this phenomena. What is a phenomena? And I didn't go too deep into it, but one definition is a group affecting outside of itself, and it is something of itself something that affects outside of itself, you know, that becomes something of itself. That is Rastafari. Let I remind all that the William Lynch, evil him, you know, wicked him, William Lynch letters describes the same scenario, that if properly applied, you know, your slaves would be enslaved for, you know, 300 or 400 to even 1,000 years. As long as this phenomena, it's even as clear as saying, I, you know, forgive I, because I haven't gone over the William Lynch letters in a while, but I remember clearly that it spoke of this phenomena, that it was the only thing that could disrupt the mental and physical slavery. So that's interesting in itself. So let us deal with I and I economy, Jai economy. What is our economy? It is the management of our home, you know? And so Jai tells us what our economy is, you know? Keep walk in my way, keep my commandments, do my statutes, you know, hold on dearly to my judgments, you know? He promises I and I everything that he has promised our fathers, you know. And so all we have to do is you know, walk the walk, you know. So that is our economy, and it is with this that we will disarm the world, not physically, well, the physical will come, but first we must make our wills obedient to that good influence. We must live the correct and healthy life which we have been taught to do so in the Bible. That in which His Majesty glories, even Jesus Christos, you know, we must keep that word agreement and put meaning and content and honor it, you know. It is that which will inevitably be the destruction of whatever wicked systems they have out there. And it's not even going to be, listen, I know for a fact that, you know, the more that we do good and keep straight with Jah, or at least do what is right in Jah's sight, Babylon shall fall. And it's, you know, I've come to the conclusion, I hope many out there come to the same conclusion, it's not these videos promote the, you know, the doing of the keeping the good, I mean keeping the good. These videos promote and encourage being obedient to a good influence and keeping the commandments, but it's not the videos, it's not if we set up a community, a Rastafari community, it's not if we do this or that. It's if we all walk according to the way which Jah intended us to walk, that will bring about the kingdom faster, you know. Still, we have to be patient. We'll get into that. So let us continue by mentioning that first we must hear the word, then we must remember Shema, and then remember the Sabbath, and then do it, walk the walk, you know, walk and follow in that good example left not only by Jesus Christus but our God and Father, you know. Kedamawi Haile Selassie. So let us continue. Let us continue going now. Now we could go a little further into this week's Sabbath study. Well, last week's. Okay. So let us go to Deuteronomy chapter 7. And it starts with verse 12. But listen, I don't want to make these videos too long. So let us begin with verse 13. Chapter 7 of the book Deuteronomy, verse 13. And it reads, "And he will love thee, and bless thee, and multiply thee. He will also bless the fruit of thy womb, and the fruit of thy land, thy corn, thy wine, and thine oil, the increase of thy kind, and the flocks of thy sheep, in the land which he sware to thy fathers to give thee. Thou shalt be blessed above all people, Ayindai Rastafari. There shall not be male or female barren among you, or among your cattle. And the Lord will take away from thee all sickness, and will put none of the evil diseases of Egypt, which thou knowest, upon thee, but will lay them upon all them that hate thee." So, okay, already we've gone into disease and ignorance. Diseases, it's pretty clear, right? But ignorance, where was ignorance? You know, why would it mention that, you know, Jah will bless the fruit of thy womb and the fruit of thy land, but then male or female shall be barren among you, nor your cattle? Because if I go to some of the word definition and all that, I find out that what is a fruit? A fruit is that which contains seed within itself. That's similar to that phenomena, you know, something affecting of itself. So a fruit has its seed within itself, and we could go deeper to that, but I don't think it's time. I'll give I an idea of what I mean by going deeper into it or further to it. You know, the reason why our parents may not have cared about this spiritualism or this truth, better yet, is because I had to be cut off, you know, Jah's land had to be left desolate. You know, Ethiopia had to be left with none of her children to cut us off, because those that were, you know, directly on the land lost their mind, and those that and even here in the Americas, we had to be cut off. It wasn't, man, this is, I can't help it, but I have to bring in the matter with, you know, how Jamaica, not to offend Jamaicans, you know, but you know how it's been said that they still had some of that warrior spirit, right? That is great, but it's not what Jah intended for I and I, because that warrior spirit had to be killed, had to be abolished, because that same warrior spirit was affecting Jah economy, was not being obedient to Jah. And so here we had to come from a elder generation that or most had to come from that generation that just didn't care about Jah, you know, because to be cut off, to be made new from scratch, you know, and there's evidence for this, we'll go into it. And we had to be that phenomena, that fruit within itself, because we did not possess that fruit from I and I parents, you know. And so that is that. And continuing, Jah will drive out the nation slowly. See, that's that whole process, you know. Everything he's been doing for so long has been to create this phenomena, you know. All we have to do is keep his commandments, walk the walk, you know. So womb, in this case, in this term, in this verse, the definition of womb is a female member, the belly, hollow, empty, like a valley, like the valley of the dry bones, spiritual Egypt, like the belly of the whale, you know, spiritual Egypt, I and I, you know, inside the belly of the whale, empty, hollow, you know, empty your cup, Jah fill it up anew, you know, because some of that old one, you know, some of the stuff that our parents possess are great, you know, but it's not what Jah intended. Jah was seeking something else with I and I, and so that cup had to be emptied to start new. You know, drink that new wine, that new blood, you know, that new fruit within itself to cause this phenomena, affect all that which is around I and I, and get this ball rolling, you know, and greet the new day, greet the new era with happiness and joyful singing towards Jah Rastafari, you know. So continuing, it's interesting because the Ethiopic, I don't know if from this, still regarding the womb in this particular verse, but I'm not sure if it was the first definition or the root meaning in the Blue Letter Bible Dictionary, but the Ethiopic was Bane, like Bane Ha, like sun, but in the Ethiopic, it refers to corpse, that dead body, that, you know, the valley of the dry skulls, or dry bones, or something like that. Forgive I for not referencing that to its exactness, but you know, I got all kinds of things. I'm not that great at this. I got a lot in mind, but let us continue. Valley of the dry bones, the skull, you know, crucified at Golgotha, the place of the skull, in the ras, in the head, in the beginning, in the first, but corpse, where the corpse are at, the vultures will be, you know, corporation. I remember that from a previous study. Nonetheless, the dead, you know, I and I were to die. You know, I and I were to die and to renew within ourselves. Even that makes sense, you know, within the belly of ourselves, you know, in complete emptiness, yet hanging on to the wholeness, you know, and then resurrecting in the spirit. And because of Jah Rastafari, Kedamawi Haile Selassie, sending his first son, you know, to the world, first begotten to the world to so that I and I can resurrect, you know. So continuing, proceeding with that, this is still regarding education, you know. So now we have the opening, you know. That's the first thing I thought when the womb, the fruit of the womb, I was thinking the opening of the mouth, the off. You know, the breathing, the inhaling, and which is what the universe is composed of. It's impulse. But nonetheless, continuing, because that's aside the point. That's what I got. But then continuing on reading, kind of, it's just something about that word, you know, what is kind. It didn't say kindred or you know, that kindest, you know, it said kind. What is that, you know? Going into it, definition, Blue Letter Bible Dictionary was ox, cow, but then the Hebraic words were aleph and alpha. Now, keep in mind that in the Ethiopic Amarena, aleph, ilf, aleph, man, I forgot, but I forgot if it's ilf or aleph or aleph. It's not aleph, it's if, ilf, or aleph. But the definition for that is innumerable. You know what? I give thanks because just received where it is I have to go to properly reference that. I hope. I'm sure it's got to be. You know what? It'll come to mind. But it the definition for it is innumerable, like so much that you can't count. And that's basically what's being described here. If. There we go. Let I write that down just because it was so hard to come across. So it would be ilf. Ilf would be thousands, innumerable. And that kind of fits into the next words that are gonna be used, you know, Jah will multiply thee, you know, and so on and so forth. Just to show the direct, the relationship from the Hebraic, the Ethiopic. And so let us continue by making mention that we were Aleph and Alpha, which are the mouth, you know, it corresponds to the mouth. So the definitions for that were to get accustomed to learn and to teach and to accustom oneself, to familiarize oneself, to tame, to make gentle, to associate, to join, to come together, you know. We could even go back to the speech, you know, the ultimate challenge, but let us not do so. Let us not lose track, as I and I often do. To learn, you see, this is the education. The learning has to be passed on from generation to generation. This last week's Torah portion studies, in a section I can't recall, but it goes into explaining how, and thou shalt tell your children every opportunity you can. You shall tell them the commandments, you know, and the rules and the judgments, the statutes. You should write them on your doorpost, on the walls, you know. You should put them in your hand as a sign, you know, in your frontlet or in your forehead, like frontlets or something like that. And you should speak of them when you lay down, when you go to sleep, when you're walking, when you're eating, everything, you know, because that is the learning. Fortunate are them that learn through acquired wisdom, or to pass through passed on knowledge, and not through their, you know, not having to go through bitter experience, personal experience, the way I and I had to learn, becoming a fruit within itself, you know, fruiting from itself. And so that's basically the idea, you know, coming to self from self. That's basically the idea that's trying to be, that's where education and ignorance is. You know, ignorance came from the lack of knowledge being passed on by the older generation to I and I. Let us not cause that same problem. That reminds I that the ultimate challenge speech, I see that one of the most important lessons to learn from it in its entirety is to learn a lesson to perfect I and thyself. What is perfect? Correcting I and thy errors, not our mistakes, not letting them be stamped upon the book of life as permanent, everlasting errors. No, let us humble I and thyself and make those corrections. Let us learn from I and thy mistakes and And that is perfection, you know, because that will never happen again. And if it does, now for sure, next time it won't ever happen. There won't be a next time. That is the perfection that I and I seek. And the ultimate challenge speech, you know, His Majesty is perfect. You know, his words are manna from the sky. You know, what is it? Some would say, I and I know what it is. It's bread of the highest kind, you know. That's my dog. He's trying to be all. Okay, continue. Okay, let us continue. Let us circumcise. This is an opportunity because he's trying to grab my attention. Let us circumcise that extra flesh from our hearts. You know, unfortunately, we have to do it. You know, Jah is spiritual in truth, and he can manifest in the physical as he's shown I and I so clearly, not even only once, you know, but more than once. But I and I gotta let go of the flesh, you know, and so forget about them, cause we gotta handle job business, you know, set up the economy, and we've been through that, or manage the economy more correctly. Now I and I is gonna jump. Oh man. I have to jump over to a few verses, and not to get so disease. We'll deal with disease in a second. Okay, so I don't see it, but I know it's there, so I'm going to just start reading. It's chapter 7, verse, let's start from verse 18. Thou shalt not be afraid of them, but shall well remember that the Lord thy God did to Pharaoh, and what the Lord thy God did to Pharaoh and to all Egypt. The great temptations which thine eyes saw, and the signs, and the wonders, and the mighty hands, and the stretched out arm, whereby the Lord thy God brought thee out. So shall the Lord thy God do to all the people of whom thou art afraid. Moreover, the Lord thy God will send the hornet among them until they are left, and until they that are left hide themselves from thee be destroyed. The hornet, which is what I wanted to go into. The hornet, that is interesting, because in the book of Babylon, from Babylon to Timbuktu, the hornet is, Thutmose III is referred to as the hornet. Let us do a little review really quick. This is interesting. The Egyptian empire was crumbling. The hornet has to do with disease, okay? So, okay, just making that known. The Egyptian kingdom was collapsing, empire, whatever, it was collapsing. Here come the Hyksos. The Hyksos brought horses and chariots. The Egyptians were terrified, they had never seen that. So the Hyksos were immigrants. It is when the Hyksos, according to from Babylon to Timbuktu, during the rule of the Hyksos, it is when Joseph and the Hebrews were favored. That is interesting. And just keep note. Later here come Thutmose first, and they regained the country. And now the Hebrews are less favored, you know. Let us deal wisely with them, lest they should, you know, join the enemy in any kind of war. And so now the Egyptians, Thutmose first, established a kind of like a fascist, like military, like strict government. Forgive if I'm pronouncing it wrong, I'm sure I am, but the third, he takes his father down, but he is known as the flying hornet, and check this out, it's funny, because a hornet is defined in the blue letter Bible dictionary as piercing. Okay, it's not defined, you know, because it could be considered a wasp or a hornet, But the signification of it is what it's trying to represent. It's the piercing and the striking. Those that have pierced him will see. It is said in scripture, right? Continuing, it is this piercing and striking that shall drive out the Canaanites in due time with patience and slowly. You know, lest the beast of the field overwhelm us, or outnumber us, or something like that. You know, forgive I for not being so exact, you know. So continuing, what I'd like to make mention is that piercing, striking could be when one is stricken or smitten, one can be signified as being prostrated. One is, you know, it's like if you don't humble yourselves willingly, I God and Father, he might feel free to like humble thee like some other way, and maybe by if it means that you have to be stricken or smitten. So that's the idea behind that, you know. Not only humbling, but it's defined as a disease of skin, you know, a disease, and it's leprosy. It's being multicolored, kind of leprosy. And so that's all interesting because until the philosophy that the color of a man's skin is of no significance, that is a disease in mind, you know. That is one of the diseases. That this pertains to disease, and not only that, but the establishment of true equality. You know, I not deal with no flying hornets, you know. I just seek Jah truth. And so Jah truth is true equality amongst all men, you know, and women, children. But when I say man, it includes them. And so that's that. But let I remind once, you know, long ago, Garden of some video regarding that Brother Agassa inspired because of his sharing of his garden, and so inspired I and I to share a little of I and I garden. Not a garden, just some knowledge that I and I had. So continuing with that, spear and striking. Cain is a spear, you know. Cain is a weapon, and once again, economical weapons, right? Well, Cain is a spear. He's a deadly spear. And if you recall, His Majesty, on addressing the issue of disarmament, he goes on to say that ever since the Stone Age, man's production of arms has been like self-annihilation. Let us go to that, because it's great, you know. It's some awesome, like some great information, and it's, you know, I give thanks to be able to share this, because I think it's brilliant. And now it's a question of whether am I going to be able to find it quickly. Because the elimination of nuclear warheads from the arsenal attitudes required disputes between nations. Disarmament is vital because it possessed. Ever since the Stone Age, the production of arms have always been the source of man's own destruction. See how whatever I would have thought can do no justice to the words of His Majesty. And this isn't even the Amarena, you know, the Amharic. So, you know, I could only wonder that it's probably that much greater. So, the production of arms, ever since the Stone Age, this is referencing to Cain, to that spear, even to the hornet, you know. Ever since the Stone Age, ever since Cain decided to become a weapon, the stone can only build. You know? Well, I build with the stone, but I guess that is another idea, another lesson that, let us build and create, because let us not destroy. So that is what's going on. Cain is the source of destruction. Ever since Cain decided to become a weapon by using the stone for wrong, and smiting, striking, piercing his brother, and ever since that, weapons have been the source of man's own destruction. You know, and if you know, knowledge, if not applied, knowledge can create, but if not applied correctly, be sure that it can't destroy kind of deal. And that's another quote of His Majesty, not quote, you know, it's what I remembered, but it's something similar to that. So now we're getting an idea of disarmament. So the disarmament comes from Iandai economy, you know. When Iandai you know, demand and require the world to accept the teachings of His Majesty, because that is what it's going to come down to. It's not even a if you want. It's going to be that you must obey the commandments and follow and walk in that way, you know. If the I want to be present in Iandai kingdom, you know, Jah kingdom. And so it is when Iandai stop being that weapon, that weapons, that disarmament will be manifest, you know. Because that's why His Majesty says, and I'm not saying that because because of this that all is going to be well, you know, because His Majesty knew that the weapon was the man, you know. Because a gun don't fire. Well, first of all, we don't need guns, so let's use another example. A stone. Why would a stone be a weapon? It's not a weapon. The weapon is that evil that wicked mentality, that wrong state of mind, you know, wanting to do hurt, not having goodwill. That is the weapon. So that is how disarmament will come along. It's up to Iandai, all of us, you know. We are inevitably those weapons. And yeah, I guess it's a good time to divert over to Moses and from Babylon to Timbuktu. Because, interesting enough, so after the time of Thutmose III, well, around that time, and then the I guess the coming along of Ramses first or second, somewhere in between, I kind of forgot the story. Give me just 1 second. Should I go to that, or Iandai is confronted with a dilemma? Let I just continue. 40 years. Okay, the 40 years in the wilderness. Let I say that we are in the wilderness. Just really quick, I wanted to present some thoughts on our experience here in spiritual Egypt. But let me just sum it up really quick. Spiritual Egypt here is Jah's main focus. Not to make any other tribe, any other people less, but it's. You know, you could see how other tribes and other Rastafari communities, all Latin America and the Caribbean islands, you can see how they it seems that they have progressed and gone ahead, right? But only because they have progress to show for, and because it's physical. But remember, Jah kingdom isn't physical. Jah kingdom is spiritual, and so in truth, and so what are they missing? Yeah, they can. Set up establishments and communities, Rastafari, and do, but they're all doing it wrong, because the judges will come out of Egypt, you know. Those that are going to be able to guide and lead in the right direction, the physical, are going to come out of Egypt, you know, because some of them are stuck to their, and this isn't to offend or make less, we're all equal, but we all have our roles, you know, to play. So some of them are still stuck to some of their ancestors' traditions, you know, and so Jah can't deal with that, because we know what the ancestors did. They betrayed Jah, and so Jah need brand new bottles to put brand new wine in it, and to kind of guide the rest of the movement. So that's what Judahites, Afro-American Shemites here in the Americas do not even think for 1 minute yes, there's more than we could do, and that's only because His Majesty teaches that until one takes on more than he can possibly handle, man can do that which he can possibly, well, until that man can know what he can possibly do, you know, until he takes on more. And so, you know, Judahites, keep strong, you know, keep your heads up. You know, I pray that Iandai isn't the first to say this, but I'm going to say it, that it's all Judah, you know, it's all the tribe of Judah, and you know, all you Afro Shemite Americans here in America, in spiritual Egypt, are Jah's, you know, our Jah main main dish, you know, you're all, you know, just be proud of yourselves, you know, because Ja got some good stuff in store for Ayandai. And if Ayandai can't see that progress, Ayandai is blind, because you know, Wendem Yaron, the Lion of Judah Society, has done so much, and it may seem like a small thing, but it's not. It's doing more than we can possibly see visibly. So, but knowing your hearts that Ja don't mess around, he's not fooling around, he's not pretending. This is coming together, and I hope I've shown some light on why it is that here in America we can't kind of see the progress. And it's because, come on, let's be honest. Where else can people in America, let's say we all got in a caravan, and this is because I saw a video. A whole bunch of Rastafarians, you know, get different cars without license plate, no seatbelts, just chanting Naya Bingi, drumming, and you know, over the limit of people per vehicle, and just in a caravan going downtown and celebrating, you know, Rastafari. Where can that be done in America? It can't be done. You know, God forbid that I don't know, your license plate sticker is a little blurry, because then you'll have to, you know, then you'll be pulled over and have to deal with years of paperwork and lawyers and doctors. I know, don't ask I why, but it gets to that point. You know, you run a, you don't make a complete stop, and all of a sudden you're dealing with doctors and lawyers and your high school teacher, because that's America. It's prison, you know. And yes, the physical is well satisfied, you could say, but that is this study teaches us that in the wilderness, Jah taught us that it wasn't food alone that fed a man, you know. And so we're here because Jah is to humble we. Jah wants to prove us. Jah is proving us. Jah wants to know what's in our heart. He wants to know if we're gonna keep his law or not. That's what's going on. We, you know, give thanks to Jah that we have food, you know. But others that are lacking food, how will they ever know that food isn't what sustains a man, you know? So it's impossible, because they want to eat, you know. You know, Jah do what he do, and he know why he do it, you know. So let's not go deep into that. But that's the reason why we had our shoes and good clothing, and we were fed, because Jah wanted us to be like, nah, man. It all this material and physical matter, it don't matter, you know. I had to separate from my Ayandai families and get to that point where, man, I don't even want to be a part of you, because listen, we have everything, some more than others, right? But in America, I guess a majority are kind of okay, and so like, but enough to realize that, you know what, I'm not satisfied, I'm still hungry, and I just ate, you know. I'm still cold, and I got a brand new jacket, you know. I'm my feet hurt, and I got brand new sneakers, and so that's what's going on, you know. So don't feel, in these poorer countries, and I say poor in the sense that they're not classified as first world countries, you, although they suffer in those senses, people are free, you know. People are free. You can kind of bump into a car and not have to deal with like decades of paperwork and stuff like that, because people aren't, you know, people are free, you know. I would have to like explain that in another video, so not to get off track. So let us continue. Just know that enslavement and mental captivity can best be expressed in America and in the United States of Satan, of the wicked them, you know. And plus, let me just mention this, and I pray I can go over this in another video. Remember the angels, how they were dissing on Adam. Look, Adam transgressed, and Jah be like, listen, I don't know why you guys get yourself so worked up. You don't transgress because you can't. I made you not to transgress, you know. Adam is different. And so they still try to be talking some smack regarding Adam. Yeah, but you told them not to eat from the tree if you hadn't told them. And this is referencing the Kevra Negas concerning the fallen angels. And so, yeah, you told him, if you wouldn't have told him, everything would be cool, you know, because he didn't know. But you told him, and we wouldn't have transgressed. Pride, trying to exalt themselves. And John, didn't I just tell you? Like, aren't you? How foolish are you? So the angels end up making an agreement, a covenant with John, and so they go. They're sent to Earth. What happens? Chaos. You know, everything goes wrong. Not to John. John knew. You know, John's the creator. He knew. There's a reason why Jah is compassionate towards some of I and I, and why Jah is so charitable and so loving and so compassionate and so merciful, because he knows what situation each is in. Jah knew that under Jah knew that the angels on earth would be beyond, like, I guess, beyond sinful, beyond transgressive, you know. So John was merciful on Adam, because he knew under the circumstances, being that Adam has to actually deal with physical needs, you know, the natural needs of the human body, he did fairly well, and John knew that. But the angels, you know, trying to exalt themselves, you know. So it's, take that in consideration, and know that Sin City is, or the sin country of the world, is U.S. It's like the devil's playground. It's like sins, you know. It's just sinful, and that is why, take that in consideration. Maybe it's because some of these other brothers and sisters, not to diss on them and not to disrespect, not to make them less or you know, it's, we all have different roles to play. Maybe some of them would have been worse here, and I can testify that my mother, you know, she was brought up from, you know, the poor of the poor, you know, really horrible conditions, you know, traumatized, you know. She came up, you know, now she's in the States, you know. She's loving it. She loves the world, you know. Do you think she even thinks about who it is that lifted her up? Nah, because now she gets to gamble and go here and go there. See, that's what I'm trying to say. Some people just wouldn't be able to deal with all this sin. It would be too much temptation. And I is like kind of rejecting that, and so people think that we're crazy, because why would you be against the freedom of being with a man or a woman, you know? Why would you be against that? Why don't you want to gamble? Why don't you want to get wasted, you know? It's like, this is heaven, but in reality it's hell. So that's what that is. Let us continue. Man, there's so much, but yeah, let us, you know, just continue and see how much we get done. Jah willing a lot. So, and after that, it mentions that I and I are to burn images and destroy kings. Are we not doing that? Has not our brother Yadon, has he not practically annihilated so-called Dr. King? Yeah, you know, I and I is destroying kings. So that's why we gotta testify and record truth. You know, it's not really to, it's first of all, because we're workmen, need not be ashamed. We're supposed to be proud of this, and not prideful, bro. Okay, let's not even get into that. But we're supposed to be happy and joyful about this, and proclaim, you know. His Majesty lets us know that you know, Old Testament miracles were done, great miracles, but now New Testament, it was, you know, Jesus Christ sent his apostles, disciples, and Paul and everyone to preach to the world. So that is what I and I are to do, preach. And burning of images, are we not burning images every time we post the truth of the Cesar Borgia or Caesar, Kaiser Borgia or whatever, and the creature? That, I think that's brilliant, but yeah. So yeah, we are kind of, just, I throw that in there just so that ones can see the manifestation of the word becoming flesh, and how it is so simple to contribute to it, you know. Just be honest about it. Every time, like my brother's new born baby daughter, every time, because my mom always says that, oh, you know, Jah willing, or God willing, or God, if God, but she don't mean God, she means if there's enough cash. So every time she talks, like, she'll be cuddled, pretending she loves my brother's daughter, and she'll mention Christ or something like that, and I'll jump in and be the real one, the Ethiopian, you know, the one that came from Ethiopia, you know, not Caesar Borgia. And my mom's always like, why do you always gotta, like, bring Why do you always gotta, like, I guess kind of like, be, I don't know the direct translation, but not ridiculous, but why you gotta be like, kind of like, messing around all the time, you know? She knows it's true. She gives me this look where she, that look is kind of like, just be quiet, you know? I've put up with enough. And but she knows it's true. She knows, you know, if she would get over that pride, she would testify that His Majesty is I and I God and Father, that Jesus Christos came in the Ethiopian flesh, you know? But her pride, you know? But yeah, she can't deny, no one can deny, and that's why they hate I and I, you know? What are they to say? They can't diss the truth, you know? They can't shake that which was built on the rock. So let us continue. Now we're going to deal with poverty. We're going to go into some detail on the land that we are to inherit. And so let's start with Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 9. A land wherein thou shalt eat bread without scarceness. Let us stop there. Okay, without scarceness. What is scarceness according to the Blue Letter Bible Dictionary? Well, scarceness is poverty. A land without poverty we shall inherit. It's poor, misery. Economically, the world says that the price of an object is the value of an object is the labor put, the amount of labor, the value of labor put into that product. Well, I only value Jai economy, you know. But I mentioned that because, and it'll make sense right now, so let it continue. Okay, let I just pause right there. Because machines, all right, máquina. What does that mean? In Spanish, it means a machine. In the Ethiopic, it's a car, right? Cars, machines, máquina. They devalue, they make everything poor. They cause the scarcity of this world because they devalue the labor of man's work with his hands. They make everything faster, quicker, cheaper, therefore inexpensive, you would say, and still very expensive considering the fact that they're gaining like 1,000,000% profit. They have slave labor. They're not even taking care of the waste, you know, from their factories. They get the resources free. They probably get it off, they pay with our taxes probably, and then the resources are free because they buy in such abundance, you know. So these wicked them, they're gaining like thousands and thousands of percentage in gain. So inexpensive would not be a good way to put it, you know. And so machines make everything poor. The devaluing of a man, the devaluation or evaluation, they say, right? They devalue a man when they're with the little clipboard and they start saying what's that? Oh yeah, this and that. Like, they don't evaluate. They're kind of devaluating. It's like, I'm a man. That's all you gotta know. I'm a man. You know, equal before the eyes of Jah Rastafari. You know, as equal. They should be equal within I and I's sights as are equal before heaven, you know. And I and I, God and Father, Kedamawi Haile Selassie. Continuing, not to get off track, like most of the time. So, produces cheaper products. Take note. Before, you know the cross builders in Ethiopia, handed down that knowledge handed down from generation to generation. Check this out. They say that started in Egypt, but Egypt has no one that can do it. But somehow a video says that the cross art form of Ethiopia, I recommend it. The narrator says somehow Ethiopians know how to do this. Well, because it originated in Ethiopia, but they were considered laymen. They were considered the poor, those that worked with their hands. And let I reference Kebra Negesht when Solomon tells Queen Makeda of Sheba that he pulls aside one of his workers working on the temple, and Solomon he tells Queen Makeda of Ethiopia of Sheba that look at this man. This man is stronger than I. This man is this, this, and that. He starts kind of like laying it, speaking how it is. And why? How am I any better? I'm only a good if I kind of like help the situation. If not, well, I'm no better than him. He's in fact stronger, and he can survive better and stuff like that. So just referencing that, and I say this because learn a trade. First will be last, the last will be first. Learn a trade. Learn to do stuff with eye and eye hands. That is, we live in a world where no one can do nothing. Everyone is useless. No one can do anything. Do whatever it is that you can, but learn how to use your hands, because we're entering a new age, Ja age, that there's not going to be no devaluing of reality, of truth. It's going to be, everyone's going to be rich, and you're only rich if you can produce with your hands, you know, as far as the physical world, you know. And we're not going to be dealing with these machinery that only cheapen everything and make cheap the human man, women, and children, you know. And so let me just add this, because I think it's funny, it's hilarious, I would say. Kind of like in a Isaac laugh, not a kind of like in spirit and in truth, you know, but not making fun of it. But so poor in the Ethiopic would be meskene. And the reason I put that up there is because it's kind of like meskene. You know, like Mexican, you know, and not to make fun of anyone, but or myself, but yeah, that's, I thought that was pretty interesting. Mexican, and another way of saying that would be, what was it, mesquite? Even that one. Mexican, you know, like, oh, if you want to, like, kind of pronounce every word, so-called, right, but in reality, it would be mesquite, you know, but if you want to go word by, letter by letter, or fidel, it would be mesquite, you know, quine. Anyways, yeah, just thought I'd throw that in there, because of the direct, like, relation. So learn a trade, you know. I work on some of these, I don't know if you can see that, but you know, on you know, every once in a while, just carving some of these things. You know, the expressions I get from people, it's like I'm nuts, it's like I'm crazy, you know. You know, if we come into these times where machinery aren't available and stuff like that, how are we gonna like deal with everyday liberty, you know? So Rastafari, you know, learn how to plant fruit and vegetables, learn how to everything that we learn, let's learn to do it like with our hands, you know, to not be depending on machinery, because machinery only works if it's even there, and if the way that they are, I guess they get going, they start working if that is available. For instance, gas, you know, if gas isn't available, that machine that's your job, you know, if you cut grass and you don't have gas, then guess what, you don't really know how to do anything now, do you? So just an example. So let us continue, and that is interesting, because let us just really quick go to Deuteronomy 9, I believe. So this is when Moses comes down and with the two tables, and he I and I are worshiping the golden calf. Okay, so it's chapter 9, Deuteronomy, verse 21. and I took your sin, the calf, which ye had made, and burnt it with fire. So this is Moses speaking. He took our sin, the calf that we had made, and burnt it with fire. So he tried it. He tried it with, you could say that he judged it with fire, you know, as I and I are to be flexible. You know, if we're tried by fire, I and I will not be destroyed, you know, because I and I is flexible. I and I could be fire, you know, I and I could be wind. I and I could be liquid, you know. I and I could be I always forget the last one. Gas, liquid, solid. I and I could be solid, you know. I and I could be plasmos or light, you know. Let us continue. I can't recall why I said that, but yeah. So continuing, and stamped it, and ground it very small, even until it was as small as dust. And I cast the dust thereof into the brook that descended out of the mount. So he tried, I and I, bring to Jesus Christos, a gold tried by the fire. He stamped us. He humbled us. He chattered us to pieces. He pounded on us. He struck us. He struck the rock, you know. See if it was gonna hold up. He give it a second. So okay, forget that. Okay, but continuing with the same topic, that so he so after that, and I made a mistake. I gotta go back to it because I kind of forgot what was going on. So he stamped it, crushed it, and grounded it. You know, that could be humbling. You know, grounded it, a groundation. You know, getting your feet back on the ground. You know, for some of us that like to fly. And then until it was as small as dust, maybe innumerable, Aleph, you know, like the innumerable thousands, like the stars up in heaven and the sand on earth, you know, I and I as Rastafari. So as dust, and I cast the dust thereof into the brook that descended on the mount. So he threw us, he judged us, threw us into the river Jordan. The brook that descended. Brook are many streams, and then that descended down the Jordan. So descended Jordan, that's what it means. And so this has to do with judgment, and we'll go into it. It has to do with the Jordan River and how it is that when I and I get to the okay, let's not go into that right now. Let us deal with some interesting aspects of this. So let us know that molten cast with metal, molten is cheaper, you know, keep that in mind. Anoint to pour out, to honor. So what gives value to the economy, you know, is if we decide to give meaning and content and value and honor it, you know. So that's molten. Calf, round, revolve, revolution, the industrial revolution could be, definitely is, completely related to this. You see, the molten, the valuing, the devaluing even, a calf, round, so no longer having the calf help I and I, but having machine revolve around, revolutionizing, you know, revolving around the machinery is poor, you know, it's a poor economy. So, you know, and there's more, but man, there's so much. Stay tuned for part 2. Shalom, give thanks, you know. Jah God and protect all and die.